Good morning, students. Hope you're all hale and hearty and fine after the weekend. Yes, you're all doing good. That's nice. So let's continue with our teaching, right? And on the last lecture that we had not discussed informal letter writing. We had discussed the letter which was there in your chapter, discussed the format, how to write various kinds of content. Now for your notebook, for your homework, I'm giving you one letter. Please note down the question. That is, write a letter to your cousin inviting him to your grandfather's 75th birthday. Informal letters, whom do we write to? We write to our friends, our relatives, to our acquaintances, people that we know, people that we are familiar with. And yes, you're quite... Wait, the students are still joining. Okay. Okay, so here in this letter, what are you going to write? You know the format. What is the format? Format is the sender's address and the date. Who is the sender? You are. You're writing the letter, you write the date, and of course, your suitable salutation. So dear cousin, Rina, dear friend, whatever is the person you whom to writing to, okay? Accordingly, the salutation will be. First, you will be, yes, you will just, you know, like, of course, talk about the reason for writing the letter, about the health, asking about his well-being, right? That I hope you and your family are all fine. And yes, so he's keeping safe during these times. And right, and you can talk about, yes, that we are also taking proper precautions and staying safe during these difficult times. And you can see now that the restrictions have been lifted. We have decided it's time for the family to come together. And we'd like to, you know, celebrate our grandfather's 75th birthday. Right. So last year also, we were unable to celebrate it. And it's a special occasion. And I would be very, very thankful, or I'll be very happy, delighted, if you could join us in this celebration. So when we invite a person for a celebration here, what all are you going to mention? Yes, what all are you going to mention in the invitation? You're going to mention the place, where are you celebrating? And of course, in these times, which is the best place to stay? At home, right? You'll give the date, when you're going to have the birthday party, right? Yes, so like you can say it's 29th of July or 3rd August, and the time, right? From, you can say, right, what, 7 p.m. onwards or 6 p.m. onwards, whatever time you can. And after you have written this, you will definitely give a reminder. You will just say that why, you know, it is very important for this cousin of yours to be a part of the celebration. That, right, it's a very important day in the life of my grandfather, and I want everyone to be a part and, you know, like participate in his happiness and on this special day. And please do take our time, because I'm going to miss you if you don't turn up. So in formal letter, yeah, you do get a little casual. The way you're talking with your friends, with your cousins. So this is one major, major difference. Okay, right? And then in the end, your cousin, write your name. Will you be able to write this letter? Yes. Will you be able to write this letter? Give me a yes or no, whatever. Yeah, you will be. Okay, fine. Right? So in your notebook, you are going to write this letter. So apart from the other questions which I have told you, you will be doing this writing skill also. Right? So do not make it too lengthy also, because it is a simple invitation. It is not describing an event or describing a visit. So it is just a very simple, easy letter to write. Right? Okay? So you're going to do this in your notebooks neatly and nicely. And you will send it to me after your work is completed, right? So let me start with the next topic that we are going to discuss today. That is, please open your books, right? And there is a poem over there. Can you see? Yes, The Last Bargain. The estimated word limit would be anything, say between 150 to 200 words. That's it. Even 150 words is okay because it's a simple invitation. You don't have to write too much extra stuff. So that way, right? So 150 words, you can keep it as the limit, okay? Now, what is the next topic that we are going to start with? We're going to start with the poem, The Last Bargain. What is a bargain? What is a bargain? It's a deal. It's an agreement. It's an offer, right? And it's an offer which benefits both the parties, right? So you go there, you want to buy something, and it is something which you will feel that I have not given extra money, and the other person will also feel that I am not at a loss, okay? Right? So that is what a bargain is about. A bargain is an agreement or an arrangement. It could be when you're selling a product also. A bargain, it could be, yes, related to your work, right? That this is your work and this is how much I'm going to pay you, okay? Now, when, for example, your discount, very good, Harkar Jyot, yeah, of course, that is I got a good bargain on this bag or on this belt, right? So, or it could be on a trip that you got a good bargain. So, of course, naturally, the company is offering that. You liked it, you took it, right? Okay, because you were getting everything that you wanted, right? All the facilities that you wanted, it was there in the offer. Or you wanted to buy these jeans or sports shoes and you got them at a very good offer. And so it is both ways, it should be agreeable to both. Now, so when we are buying something, we want to save money. When we are working, yes, I'm teaching over here. Your parents also, they are working, right? So what do you think here? When a person works for someone, what are the things that he needs to look into? What are the things that he will think about? Again, you're working for someone, you talk about the money, yes, you'll talk about the working hours, it's not too tiring and too much of work. Money is very, very important, yes, right? Now, supposing someone offers you so much, gold and jewels, and in return takes away your freedom, that you have to work for me 24/7, will you take that offer? Will you take that offer? I'm getting lots of money. I'm ready to give up my freedom for that. Will you take up such an offer? Will you? No, you won't. Because you, right? You won't. You won't. Because money is not so important as your freedom. Vedanti, right? Yes, do you agree or not? And of course, here. And someone says, okay, you work for me. I'll give you food. I'll give you nice clothes to wear. I'll give you a very comfortable office also. Will you be ready to accept that? Will you be ready to accept that offer? Yes? Will you? So it's a nice offer. You're getting clothes, you're getting food, you're getting a nice office, but you're not getting money. You need money also, right? Fine. So here also, no, we won't take this offer. We will not take this offer because why? There's no money over here, right? But someone asks you to work. You're going to allow to work the way you want to. You will have a lot of freedom. You'll get a lot of respect. You'll get a dignity, but maybe no money. Then, which among these do you think is the best offer? Lots of money, lots of facilities, no money, but lots of freedom and lots of respect. Which among these do you think is the best offer? Yes? Which is the best offer? The third one is the best offer. You want freedom, you want respect. Okay, very nice. But why not money? You're working. You are there, but you need money also. You're not going to work for free. So look at, like people around us. Yes, they earn a lot of money. They're working day and night. Are they able to enjoy that money? Do they have the time or the freedom to enjoy that money? No. So is so much money useful to us when we're not even going to use it, when we're not going to spend it? No, it's not, isn't it? Right? So at the end of the day, absolutely correct. We will take up that offer where at least we have self-respect, where we have freedom. Okay? Now, this is the poem that we are going to discuss. And of course, once again, you are going to decide which is the best offer, which is the best bargain. This poem has been written by one of the most respected poets, Rabindranath Tagore. Right? And yes, we've all heard about him. We've all read his poems also, short stories. And here, a very, very important message has been conveyed, which you people have been right to judge that money is not so important. What is freedom? You see the children working as labor in the factories, right? And yes, they are made to work under such terrible conditions. But they get money. But what has been taken away? Their childhood has been taken away. Their freedom has been taken away. Do you think they're happy over there? Do you think they're happy over there? No, they're not. They say, no, we don't want to work here. We don't want money. We want our freedom. We want our childhood. Isn't it? So many things are there in life which you have to think about. And when you really sit and think about an offer, then you start realizing what is more important. Is money important to me? Is respect important to me? Is my freedom more important to me? Right? And so this is what this poem about. So let's find out and let's read what is the last bargain. Okay? All of you, please open to your books and you will write along and try to understand this poem along with me. Okay? Right? Is the screen visible? Is it visible? Yes? Okay, that's nice. Now, a bargain is an agreement in which both parties promise to do something for each other. Someone is looking for work, waiting to be hired. He strikes a bargain but thinks it is worthless. He tries twice again but doesn't like either. Finally, in the last bargain, when he is hired for nothing, whatever, he is happy as never before. What is the bargain and why is it the best? So let us see, right? So, look at these two people here. And what do you think they are doing? They're working? Are they enjoying their work? Are they? Right, so naturally you need to do work that you enjoy and the work that gives you freedom and dignity and respect. Come and hire me, I cried while in the morning. I was walking on the stone-paved road. Sword in hand, the king came in his chariot. Okay, right. They're exchanging things, or they are doing some work over there on the seashore. So come and hire me, I cried. Who is I over here? The poet, right? The narrator, the speaker. I was walking on the stone-paved road. Where was he? On the stone-paved road. So let me read this stanza first, and then I discuss it with you. Sword in hand, the king came in his chariot. He held my hand and said, I will hire you with my power. But his power counted for naught and he went away in his chariot. So he's walking, and what does the poet say? Please hire me. Come and hire me. Hire means to give him, to take him, and in exchange for money. Right, or the deal or the bargain that has been discussed. So come and hire me, I cried while in the morning I was walking on the stone-paved road. Sword in hand came the king in his chariot. Chariot? Yes, what is a chariot? the horse driven, yes, that vehicle, right? So the king is there with his power, he has a sword in his hand, and he's very proud. He's saying, he held my hand and said, I will hire you with my power. I'm the king, I have a lot of power, I have a lot of authority, and I will hire you, right? But his power counted for naught, and he went away in his chariot. So did the poet take up his offer? No, because he's saying, I don't want to work for you because you are showing me your power, you're showing me your strength, and I'm the king, I'm powerful enough, I have that strength, or I have the power to hire you. So did he accept that offer? Not means zero. Not means zero. But his power counted for naught, and he went away in his chariot. So here in the first stanza, what is the poet saying? What is he asking for? He's asking for people to hire him, right? He was walking on the stone-paved road, and the king came in his chariot, right? He's coming, showing his power. He has a sword in his hand. He's coming on his chariot, the lavish chariot, and he's telling him that I will hire you with my power, right? Because I'm a king, I can hire you. But his power was zero. It became zero when the poet refused. He said that yes, can you hear me now? Can you hear me, students? Yes? Problem? Okay. So what is there in the first stanza? What has been discussed? Who came? The king came, and he wanted to hire the poet with his power. And how is it shown? How is the power of the king shown? He had a sword in his hand, he came in his chariot, and he is telling and talking about his authority, but it all became zero. It all became zero when the speaker, he said, no, I am not going to work for you. You can't hire me with your power. So your money and riches, they don't mean anything to me. Is this clear? Is it clear? Yes? Is it clear? Okay, fine. Now, in the heat of the midday, the houses stood with shut doors. I wandered along the crooked lane. An old man came out with his bag of gold. He pondered and said, I will hire with my money. He weighed his coins one by one, but I turned away. So he kept on walking. This young man kept on walking and on the streets. It is midday. And what is the weather like during the middle of the day? It's quite hot. And everyone is there inside their homes to save themselves from the heat. The houses stood with shut doors. I wandered along the crooked lane. Wandered, he's walking without any kind of direction, any kind of purpose. He's just walking on the streets along the crooked lane. So the lane, not straight, with curves and turns. Who came? An old man came. What did he have? He had gold. He had riches. What did the king have? The king had his power. Very powerful person. And he's showing that power with his sword, with his chariot, and he's saying, I'm powerful enough to hire you. Next comes an old man. What does the old man have? He has a bag of gold. Lots of riches he has. He pondered and said, I will hire you with my money. He weighed his coins one by one, but I turned away. He thought for some time and said, I will hire you. You come, right? And what am I going to give you in return? I have a lot of money. So by the strength, or you can say, yes, with the power of my money and the gold that I have here, I'm going to hire you. But once again, what did the poet do? He turned away. Did he take up this offer? No. Because why was money not important for him? Crooked means not straight. Crooked, right? Curved, turning around. Okay? So what are the two places here, or what are the two offers that the poet gets, the speaker gets? One is on the basis of power. Yes? Second is on the basis of gold. Does he accept them? No, he does not accept them. Okay? Right. So please take a look. And he turns them away. He does not accept these offers. Even the king's offer, he refuses. Even the rich man's offer, he refuses. Right? Clear? Yes. Right. So he has refused both the offers. It was evening. The garden hedge was all aflower. The fair maid came out and said, I will hire you with a smile. Her smile paled and melted into tears, and she went back alone into the dark. It was evening. So right from the starting of the day till the end of the day, now it's almost evening. And the garden hedge was all aflower. So right, what was there? Beauty was there around him. The flowers all around. So much of beauty. And the flowers there making everything look so beautiful. The fair maid came out. The pretty lady came out. I will hire with her smile. She's beautiful. She has a beautiful smile. And she says on the power, or you can say with my smile and with my beauty, I will hire you. Her smile paled and melted into tears. And she went back alone into the dark. Her smile paled. Her smile disappeared. That means that smile, that beauty is not going to remain forever. So her smile vanished. She was not smiling the whole time. And then what happened? She started crying. She had tears. And she went back alone into the dark. Why did she go back alone? Did this man, or did the poet, accept her offer? No, he did not. He says, no, with your beauty, with your smile, you cannot hire me. And so the lady went back alone. And into the dark, why? Because it is evening. It's getting dark, right? It's the end of the day, okay? It was evening. The garden hedge was all aflower. The fair maid came out and said, I will hire you with a smile. A smile paled and melted into tears, and she went back alone into the dark. So she disappeared. She went back into the darkness. She went inside her home. She was all alone. Because once again, this man or the poet, he refused the offer that I cannot work for someone because of the beauty or because of the beautiful smile. What do you think this person is looking for? He's refused power. He does not want gold and riches. He does not want beauty. What is it that he wants now? Yes, let's have a look here. Yes, the sun glistened on the sand, shining on the sand, the sun. And the sea waves broke waveredly. And the sea waves, they're breaking on the shore. They're coming, right? A child sat playing with shells. And there's a young child, right? And he's playing with the shells. What are the shells? From the sea. You get the seashells? Yes. He raised his hand and seemed to know me and said. So he looked at the man and he seemed to know me, as if he could understand what he wanted, and said, I hire you with nothing. I'm not giving you anything. I'm not giving you a beautiful smile. I'm not giving you gold. I'm not showing you my authority. I'm giving you nothing. Right? That means if I'm not giving you nothing, I'm not expecting also. Okay? Right? So it is a beautiful agreement where, of course, he's going to work or he's going to be there on his own terms and conditions. He will have freedom. Yes. And I hire you with nothing. From henceforward, that bargain struck in child's play made me a free man. Child's play. Like children playing, you know, you have games which children play. And the child was playing with the shells, and he was so happy there on the sand and the beautiful surroundings there, the sun setting, the sun, it's shining, and you know, like there on the shore, and the waves also breaking out, and the child playing over there. He looked at this man, recognized what this, or realized what this man wanted, and in child's play made me a free man. So it is their innocence of the child, the games that children play. In that game, what did he do? He made him a free man. Right? Which no one could do. The king could not give him freedom. The king could hire him because of his power. Even his power could not make him free. The old man had gold. The gold could not make that man free. Right? The young lady with a beauty, with a smile, even she could not make this person free. Right? She would be taking something in return. So he's saying, I hire with nothing. Right? So if I am giving you your freedom, and that is what the young man wanted. He wanted to be a free man. Okay? Yes?